Good morning, Southside Uniting Church, and welcome to our online service. My name is Reverend Esteban Lievano, and I am the Outreach and Worship Minister for Southside Uniting Church. Friends, we are so happy to share this time with you this morning. And so I invite you right now to take a moment to consider God at work in your life, God at work in our community, and the many ways in which God continues to move, shape ministry, and lead us in these different and exciting spaces. We begin by acknowledging the traditional custodians of the lands on which we gather, the Turrbal and Jagera peoples, and we pray for God's work of ongoing reconciliation for all of His children. With that said, I invite you to bow your heads with me as we pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the opportunity we have to engage with your word in our homes, to understand your Holy Spirit at work even in this place and at this time. And Lord, as we contemplate today's reading, as we raise our voices in song, we ask that your Holy Spirit be with us. Lead us and guide us by your mighty hand this day, and we dedicate this time to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
In the darkness we were waiting, without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes. To fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin came the word. From a throne of endless glory, to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King. The cross, for even in your suffering you saw to the other side, knowing this was our salvation. Jesus, for our sake you died.
Spirit, three.
Friends, this is the time in our service where we take a moment to consider our state as human beings, as children of God, as sinners. We take this moment right now to acknowledge that we live in a world that groans under the weight of sin, but that there is a hope for us, and that hope is found in Christ our Lord. I invite you to take a moment and to bring before the throne of grace the petitions of your heart. And then I am going to ask you to bow your heads with me as we pray. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are a loving and a good God, and that you hear our cries from our calamitous situation, from our place of fear, from our place of death. And Lord God, although we may find ourselves in a situation where we are afraid, where we feel like we are lacking, Father, you are here with us. So bless us, I pray, with the knowledge and understanding that your grace is sufficient to wipe out every sin, every wrongdoing in our heart, and that you are with us. And so we praise you, Lord Jesus. And at this moment, we come before you with the petitions of our heart for our redemption, for your grace. So bless us, Lord, with your presence at this moment. My friends, Christ has died. Christ has given his life for us, and by his blood we are redeemed. And together we say, thanks be to God. Amen.
This reading comes from Luke chapter 16, verses 19 to 31. There was a rich man who dressed in purple and fine linen and lived in luxury every day. At his gate was laid a beggar named Lazarus, covered with sores, and longing to eat what fell from the rich man's table. Even the dogs came and licked his sores. The time came when the beggar died, and the angels carried him to Abraham's side. The rich man also died and was buried. In Hades, where he was in torment, he looked up and saw Abram from far away, with Lazarus by his side. So he called to him, Father Abraham, have pity on me, and send me Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, because I am in agony in this fire. But Abraham replied, Son, remember that in your lifetime you received your good things, while Lazarus received bad things. But now he is comforted here, and you are in agony. And besides all this, between us and you, a great chasm has been set in place, so that those who want to go from here to you cannot, nor can anyone cross over there to us. He answered, Then I beg you, Father, send Lazarus to my family, for I have five brothers. Let him warn them, so that they will not also come to this place of torment. Abraham replied, They have Moses and the prophets. Let them listen to them. No, Father Abraham, he said, But if someone from the dead goes to them, they will repent. He said to him, If they do not listen to Moses and the prophets, they will not be convinced, even if someone rises from the dead. This is the word of the Lord.
As we consider the world at large, as we consider those who are disadvantaged, disprivileged, as we consider those who are facing poverty and calamity, I invite you now to bow your heads and to ask the Holy Spirit to be with you as we pray for the world around us. Let us bow our heads. Heavenly Father, we thank you for all that which we enjoy, that we have been given an abundance of blessings. We thank you that we live in the blessed country where, Lord God, we right now are enjoying a period in which we do not have to worry about hunger and the effects of the pandemic raging throughout the rest of the world. But we cast our minds to those who are suffering, to those who right now are grieving, to those in pain and mourning. We ask you, Lord God, to be with them, to grant them peace, to grant them your love. Help them, Father God, hear our prayers as your children stand in the gap for them and ask your Holy Spirit to be with them and to bless them. And Father, pour your love out upon this world. Help those who are disenfranchised to find their voices and to find their steps. Help those who are impoverished to discover the richness of family and community. Help those, Father God, who long to lift themselves up out of the difficulties of this life and this world, to turn to you and to seek in you, in the Holy Spirit, consolation and comfort. And Lord God, we thank you that you hear the prayers of our hearts. So bless us, I pray in Jesus' name. And the people of God said, Amen.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still and striving cease. Comforter, my all and all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took a flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe. This gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. Bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands at victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me. For I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. In life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. And no power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he. Oh, calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand. And no power of hell, no scheme of man can ever
till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ, I'll stand.
In today's Bible reading, we find something that for a lot of us may be quite uncomfortable. This conversation that takes place between the rich man and Lazarus. It's uncomfortable for us because, number one, we don't like what happens with the rich man. We would like to think that in this world, every person gets given that second chance. We would like to think that every person has an opportunity to walk in the footsteps of grace. We would like to think that every person endeavors to do the right thing. But sadly, there are those in this world who have privilege, power, and position, and use that to their advantage in such a way that they disadvantage others around them. Now, moving away from any discussions of salvation, soteriology, and eschatology, I want for us to focus in on the relationship between these two. Firstly, what is it that makes them the same? What makes these two men the same, my friends, is that they are both sons of Abraham. They are both Jews. They are both aware of an inheritance that they have found in that man who made that first covenant with God. They are inheritors of a promise, and in that promise, they are asked to uphold and adhere to certain things in life that would put them in the situation where they could honor God and the promise of Abraham, their forefather. Another thing that makes them similar is that they are both worshipers of God. They both believe in God. And yet they worship him in very different ways. For one, the power and prestige that he enjoys, he can use it to lord over others, believing that God has blessed him and that from that position, he gets to now have a say in how those blessings are meted out. For another, humbled by the reality of injustice in this world, he sits there asking for that blessing from others, recognizing that God can work through his brothers and sisters to help him through the situation in which he finds himself. That is part of what makes them very, very different. And when we consider ourselves and the Christian church, we need to consider this as well. I am drawn, of course, to that passage in the book of Acts where John and Peter are going to the temple. Once again, we have children of Abraham. They see a man begging by the gate, and as he is begging, they say, "Neither gold nor silver have I, but yet what I have, I give to you. Stand and walk," Peter says, and the man is healed and he walks. What contrast there is between these two stories is the reality of God at work in the hearts of men and women. We have an opportunity to recognize that we have been blessed. We live in the lucky country. No, I won't say that. I will say the blessed country. Right now, friends, we have the opportunity to gather together in our homes. We go and we go to shops. We are able to sit in cafes when most of the world is still huddled up in their homes, hidden away from an invisible enemy that could be coming in via a friend or a family member. We are enjoying a position of safety and privilege that few in the world can appreciate today. And as I journey in my space of outreach on behalf of our church throughout the Brisbane area, I am very quickly reminded that there are those, even in our own communities, who don't appreciate the blessings that we have got. So I am challenged, and I hope you are too, by the reality that Christ calls on us to love this world, but not love it so that we can lord over it and use our position of privilege and power. Instead, to recognize that there is something that we can offer and that we can contribute. Our reading takes place in the heart of it, at a conversation in a place of death. Lazarus and the rich man are speaking from beyond the grave. And what is it that the rich man asks? He asks Father Abraham that Lazarus would dip his finger in cold water to bring him some succor, some alleviation from his torment. Ah, if only we would hear how the world is longing for that even now, even right here in Brisbane, in our own backyards, in our own neighborhoods. We recently heard at our congregational meeting that there are 1,000 homeless people sleeping rough right now in the Southside area. I don't know about you friends, but that breaks my heart. But I find myself asking, what can I do? What is it that I can do to bring about that succor, to help lift that pain? Well, the first thing we can do is pray. That is the first and most important thing. We can ask God, we can ask the Holy Spirit to come into that space, to be with those who need comfort, those who need peace, to lift those who are right now in positions of power, prestige, and authority, to respond to the needs that they see around them. We can lend our voices to the voiceless. And there are so many different ways that we can do that. As we contemplate this morning's passage, we also find down towards the end that the rich man asks that his brothers would be told to change their lives in order to avoid a place such as that. I choose to hear that to say that they would change in order to avoid such torment. Ah, once again, I hear that in this world we are also challenged by Christ's words. We are challenged to contemplate and consider what we can change. Now, those of you who are more astute would remember that right now we are in the season of redirect for Southside United Church. And what does redirect mean? It's that point at which we turn from the things that we always did into the things that we believe Christ wants us to do. Some of us are undergoing some training at the moment, and it's so exciting to hear how our thoughts and discussions around discipleship are changing, and we are becoming more and more thinking about the ways how we can minister beyond the congregation, as well as how we can love and serve those within it. There are so many different ways in which we need to redirect our thinking and our footsteps, my friends. And I'm not saying this because what we've been doing in the past has been wrong, but because we've been walking on a certain path and a certain trajectory. And as has been the case for many people during this last year and a half, We are now looking at how our direction can change ever so slightly so that we can find ourselves walking in new and exciting spaces. Spaces where perhaps there was need that we can now meet. Spaces where perhaps we might have been too afraid to walk once before. What are the spaces, you ask me? Well, I don't really quite know. Not just yet anyway. But I know that God is preparing us for a great mission in Southside area. And we have groups like the Mission Experiment Group and the Op Shop Steering Committee who are investigating and exploring. And as we do, we are hearing and we are listening and we are finding new and exciting ways that we can serve the community. So I want to ask you to pray, like I said before. Pray for this world, pray for our neighborhoods, pray for those who are going into frontline ministry doing this investigation. And be ready. Be ready because the day is going to come when God is going to show us and he's going to say, you know what? There's this, we can do this, and there's a door that's going to open. And when that door opens, I want to think that we as Southside Uniting Church are going to be ready to go through that door, that we are going to be ready to follow in God's will. Not do the same thing that our brothers have done beforehand, but instead consider something new, something different, something exciting, and build upon that legacy. Build upon these things that have been done beforehand so that what we are doing continues to carry that spirit of blessing, that spirit of giving, that spirit of love. I commend these words to you this day. And I ask you, I charge you to continue to pray, continue to ask God, and stand at that ready, because that moment is going to come. And we want our response to be one where we can say, yes, Lord, we did what we could. We heard your voice and we followed your direction. May God bless this word to you this day. Amen.
As we come together as one congregation, one of the factors that we're having to consider is the times at which our worship services are held. At the end of last year, we introduced our current schedule, and we said that around Easter this year, we would come back and ask the question and review them. Since that time, a couple of other factors have come in, which means that we have to put that review back for a couple of months. That factor is primarily that my placement comes to an end at the end of this year, and the church council needs to consider whether my placement will continue and particularly how we're going to fund it. Until we can address that question and get a resolution to that, we're not in a place to be able to make any decisions about our schedule of worship services. So what that means is that we're going to just push back for a couple of months a review of our worship services. We'll continue with what we are, and then we will ask, how are our worship services and their times continuing to meet the needs of our congregation? On the 28th of March, it is Palm Sunday, and on that Sunday we have an opportunity to worship together as one congregation. That service will be at 9 o'clock at Yoronga. As you can see as I'm talking, there's a video that shows you the car park that's at Yoronga, the stairs that allow you to get into it, and also a ramp if you don't want to take the stairs. You access this car park via the side street, which is Kingsley Parade at Yoronga. It's a great car park, it's a great facility, it's a great opportunity for us to be one church, worshiping in one place at one time. So I invite you to come and be part of that service. During this past week, the steering committee for our proposed op shop had its first meeting, and there is some great energy and enthusiasm for what could come about from an op shop. Because an op shop embodies in one activity why we came together as a congregation. We came together because none of our four previous congregations could achieve something like this on their own. And we came together as a congregation so that we could engage with our neighbours, to be able to serve them, to bless them, to be able to meet with them. And the op shop is one way in which we are able to do that. It's still too early to give you any definite direction on where they're going, except at this stage they are talking about having it in the hall at Holland Park. It's on a busy road, it's got great access, great car parking. It's the best place for us to be able to do that. So please continue to pray for that committee and watch this space for something great that's going to be coming out.
Worship your holy name.
Church, it's been so good sharing with you this morning, coming into your homes, into your phones and tablets, wherever it is that you are finding yourselves watching this right now. This is one of the great things about our online service. You can participate in it at any time, wherever you like, and know that the Holy Spirit has been with us, entreating with us in each of these spaces. We are so blessed. I want to take this moment to thank all of our volunteers that continue to make this possible, and to acknowledge on behalf of myself and our ministry team that we couldn't do this without the body of people who are right now serving in the many different spaces in the life of our Southside Uniting Church. Thank you. Thank you all so much. I want to take a special moment to acknowledge those who have been volunteering in the space of our Mount Gravatt garage sale. I know it's been a big hit. I know that it's been a big effort that we've put in, but it's been a blessed time. And so thank you so much for that. And if you could just spare a moment to pray for those volunteers, that they would find rest and respite after the busy time that they've recently had, we would really appreciate it. With all that said, why don't I close our time together in a word of prayer and then say our final blessing. Heavenly Father, you are with us. You are with us wherever we go, Father God. Bless us with an understanding of your will, of your love in our lives, and help us go from here into our lives, into our families, into our communities, to bless and love. To acknowledge that from the place of privilege that we enjoy, we also are challenged to look at those who experience disadvantage and find ways that we can better serve them, that we can better serve the world. So give us, Father God, an understanding of what this means in our own personal journeys, and guide us to respond with the heart of Christ. And so, friends, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship we share in the Holy Spirit be with you all this day and evermore. Amen.